Hello and welcome to this conversation on Bloomberg Quint. We're sitting here with Dr. TCA Anant, the Chief Statistician of the country. He is here in Bombay. So we've requested him for a little bit of time to try and understand what's happening in the economy. Thanks so much, sir. So lots of questions, but I'm just going to start, bucket them into three areas, the first of which is GDP. Now, I think what has happened is we've had, we went from the old series to the new series. Now we've had some changes in the new series by virtue of the fact that the WPI numbers have changed and the IIP numbers have changed. What we are all feeling is that we're not being able to get a clear narrative on what's happening on growth in the economy. Can you help us based on, say, these numbers, which one would assume are the best, indicator at this point in time? What is the story on the growth front as you see it?
Okay, first of all, insofar as the latest update which was done, including WPI and IIP, first of all, if you notice, it was long overdue because we had mentioned that this was going to happen. But its implication in the growth narrative actually is quite small. And because broadly speaking, if you look at the two series, WPI, between the old and the new series, there's not much change in the basic character of the series. The two series are reasonably close together throughout. There is some difference partly on the fact that the new series excludes taxes, so it's not because of that there is a slight difference in the but in terms of its impact on GDP compilation, it's not been that much, and mainly because most of the tax related influence of the implication on WPI were concentrated in a few sectors, minerals, petroleum, fuel, power and light. Those were the sectors in which a lot of the effect was concentrated. In other segments, the differences are actually quite small. So in the manner in which we use WPI and GDP compilation, it didn't end up making that much of a difference. IIP, the differences of the two series was quite marked and quite expected also. We have commented on the reasons for that. But its impact on GDP compilation is quite muted because IIP itself plays a very limited role in GDP compilation. Now, because of that, A, the growth narrative doesn't change, and broadly, what is the growth narrative? That was the second part of the question. The growth narrative, if you look at it, basically shows that in a sustained manner, from 2011-12, our growth has improved. 12-13, we were at around 5.5%. We have now crossed 7%. It was a little higher last year. It has dipped a little this year. Partly, please understand, year-to-year movements are in part influenced by, at least in constant prices, influenced by the long-run dynamics of price movements. One of the underlying stories there, which I mentioned earlier when we released the new series, is the commodity price blip, which happened 2 years ago because of the very sharp fall in oil prices. That has worked itself out of the system. So on the whole, our growth is robust. It's high. It has been increasing. It has reached about 7% now. And all indications are that this growth improvement will continue.
But what is your understanding of what happened between last year and this year? Because, I mean, the last set of data showed that the slowdown had started pretty much from the first quarter of FY17, and nobody knows why. Is there anything in the components which can give us a sense of why a slowdown had started to come through even before demonetization and then got accentuated perhaps by demonetization?
See, to some extent, the slowdown is one of in the constant price series. And it is to be expected because of what I told you. Part of the story is in the commodity price blip. If we had a period of almost 14-15 months in which commodity prices had fallen below, that very sharp fall, and then they were low for a while, and then it started rising. So that period starts unwinding, if you like, from sometime around the end of the first quarter last year. Now, this is visible in the WPI numbers also, if you look at them. If you look at the WPI trajectory, it's negative, in negative territory until the first quarter of
last fiscal,
and then it starts rising. So, if you were to simply treat this as an event which is working itself out. And one way of reconciling that is to look at our nominal growth rates. Our nominal growth rates mirroring what is happening in the WPI is on an upward trajectory throughout. So in fact, the slowdown which you are seeing from the first quarter onward is partly a convergence which is happening because of the price behavior.
And the third and the fourth quarters, what is the analysis there? Again, if one looks at components, forgive us for, you know, making a very broad correlation, but it looks like it's demonetization related. There is construction impact, there is finance impact, there's some slowdown in personal consumption expenditure in the fourth quarter in particular.
See, the fact that there is a slowdown in construction, the numbers show it. So I can't say that there is no slowdown in construction.
And it's a contraction actually.
Yeah, in the last quarter.
The last quarter, yeah.
And similarly, there's a slowdown in financial services as well. Now, there is some element the two are connected, and I'll explain why. Because the segment which we call financial services actually is financial real estate, financial services, and business services. They're all to club together in a single segment. In that, the real estate component has a very close linkage to the construction component. The two are connected in one way, and I'll explain that story separately. There are some dynamics there which are independent of the demonetization story, but there is an import. Financial services, there are many elements to it in which demonetization is one element, but there are many other elements also playing a role there. Let me turn to real estate and construction first. The real estate and construction sector has been undergoing some degree of trouble for a while, and the slowdown was probably visible in real estate earlier as well. It is partly linked to the fact that they were heading into a number of project related problems. There were court judgments, there were issues of facing with land acquisition, and so on. So many issues were piling up there. Some of these were being resolved with this Real Estate Regulatory Authority bill. In fact, the rationale for that bill, why it was needed, it's anchored in a series of court problems also which the segment was facing, was a need to create a regulator there. Now, that industry is therefore undergoing some degree of structural adjustment as it adapts to the existence of it. I don't think it is linked to demonetization per se. This is a longer run effect in that segment, and the consequence of the regulator and the bill being passed was, I think the sector will become much more dynamic going ahead. So that's insofar as that sector is concerned.
But it could, if that is the case, then this could not, may not be a one quarter thing, then that's a little worrying.
But this is really something you should talk to people who are experts in real estate. Now, construction is partly connected to it. Not, I will not claim that the entire part of construction is linked to real estate. There is also but the two are close. But I don't think the impact on the basically private construction, I'm not sure what the story there is and what sort of impact there is. I think that will probably see a boom as personal consumption booms and personal household disposable income rises and so on. That's insofar as construction and real estate is concerned. Financial services is a more complex story. And the exactly how they interplay, it would be difficult for me to spell out in a short interview, but it is in part also linked to the fact that in the banking sector we have a largish overhang of non-performing assets, which is in part influencing credit growth. Again, the story is more complicated as that process unwinds, and it is, I don't think the linkage to demonetization is so obvious because many of these are overhang from the past. That's why when people try to sort of link these to demonetization, which is a one event with a lot of other implications, and in segments which have much more complex dynamics, it's really a question of trying to pull numbers to suit your narrative type of story, which is not really a good thing to do.
Okay, no, that criticism is taken entirely. So then are we also unjustified in worrying whether the informal sector impact has not yet been captured through GDP and may be captured in the quarters ahead, either through the consumption numbers or otherwise?
No, insofar as informal sector is concerned, I personally feel informal sector in GDP is tracked through a variety of indicators, and we have tracked them as per those indicators. One set of indicators is in agriculture, where agriculture production data and cost data gives us a sense of what has been agricultural earnings. The other is on trade, where we use sales tax collections, which have behaved as they have when they've shown up reasonably well in all of these quarters. The third is in construction, where we use, we estimate impact through basically input usage. And a large part of what we are seeing in construction is what was reflected in the data on input usage on cement and so on. Now, therefore, I don't think that we've not captured the informal sector. I think we have captured it. And the segments which I mentioned, with the informal sector's behavior is in some sense reflective of what is happening there. So I don't think there is another narrative of the informal sector outside of these.
Or that there is a lag with which the informal sector narrative will get captured.
No, I don't think that's going to happen. What the lag data will help us better understand is actually the formal sector, the corporate behavior and so on, which we are currently looking at from advanced filing of companies. You will get more complete understanding of corporate performance when we get the fuller MCA database for this period sometime around November.
So let's leave demonetization behind, because we've got another structural change coming up, which is GST. To what extent will that impact GDP data? Will it lead to some fluctuation, inconsistencies? From when, how do we start to worry of build in the impact of GST on GDP?
See, let first understand what is GST doing. GST is a taxation which is going to replace at least three major tax systems today: service taxes, value added taxes, and sales taxes. All these three are used in GDP compilation in some form. These are going to be replaced now by GST. Purely as a replacement, I don't think they're going to make much difference to GDP compilation, because from what I can make out of the GST structure, it will probably be possible to retrieve the same information which we are capturing currently in service tax collection or sales tax collection or value added tax collection from the GST database. So I don't think that should be a major hurdle. But it will constitute a structural break going ahead. And the reason is the GST is a much richer data than these three were separately, simply because it is together. So we can actually track the chain from production to final sale much more completely than we were doing in the past. It probably will make possible analysis which are currently not feasible. Now, I can't say how soon will that happen and what is, how will it be worked out and what its dimensionalities are until somebody actually sits and makes this calculation. But the potential is very rich. It will also change the structure of coverage, because there is some view that the way GSTN is constructed, there is an incentive to be part of it rather than to be not. So it may bring much larger part of our value chain into a measurable framework. So our precision will improve. Now, all of this means the GDP numbers, when this is taken into account, will probably become better. But, comparability with the past is only a partial story. I mean, for us, if we can get a much larger part of the value chain and much a larger part being tracked through formal accounting systems, our sense of what the economy is doing will be much better.
But you could have a situation in, say, Q3 or Q4 where there is a sudden shift in the numbers, because...
No, I don't think that will happen.
You don't think
that till the series is revised, we will continue to only use GSTN basically to replace sales tax and service tax collection. It won't be a new methodology. But my sense is that we are embarked on a program to revise the GDP. As part of that program, we have constituted a group which will work very closely with the people, officers in Revenue Department and GSTN and so on and so forth, to understand the framework. That is something, and it may be that the next series or I don't know the timelines. I mean, let me not prejudge this because
but 2017-18 is the base year, likely to be the base year?
Likely to the base year, but how long will that work take and so on and so forth. Because remember, GSTN is still being rolled out. And what sort of timelines before they are comfortable with the data flow and so on and so forth. These are questions which we will have to leave it to the people who manage these things to understand. But I suspect, if I look ahead, I'm very optimistic because to me it's going to be a major change in the quality of data which we get. Because it's if you just look at the structure of returns they are prescribed and the information which they are going to capture, it's going to be very rich.
So I just want to move to inflation a little bit. So now we have, you know, the new WPI series and it looks like WPI and CPI are converging. So I know you've explained this in the past that, you know, WPI, if you look at the same components as CPI, was not very divergent. But in terms of, again, constant narrative on inflation, are the two converging and do you think they'll continue to converge?
See, let's first understand what was the reason for the divergence in the first place. Basically, WPI covers both final goods and final goods, no services, and it also has a whole bunch of primary goods and intermediate goods. CPI is only final goods. It's only goods which enter your consumption basket. The reason why the two diverged is because a certain set of inputs, particularly primary inputs, crude petroleum being the most notable, had seen a major crash in their prices. Now, what has happened is these prices have now for the last 6-8 months have stabilized and are showing signs of being stable at a certain level. It is very natural that as this series converge, as these prices stabilize and you don't see that much fluctuation in individual commodity prices, the two series behavior will be dictated much more by the final consumption good prices because those are subjected to more supply demand pressure. So the two series behave closely. Even in the past, I mean, if you look over a long period of time, WPI and CPI have by and large moved similarly to each other, except for periods when there have been very sharp changes in some usually commodity price structure. So when OPEC happened, there was a big divergence between them. When it collapsed also. So those sorts of things happen. But otherwise, WPI and CPI do have a certain degree of commonality. And I think by general sense is that we have been in a very low inflation regime. In fact, I won't call it inflation at all. For the last 4 years, for all practical purposes.
Can you explain that point to us, sir? Because I think, you know, it's tough to get that. Earlier, the numbers were showing high inflation. Now, the numbers are actually showing very low inflation and we all are, concerned about what's going on.
See,
even core numbers have actually collapsed. Not collapsed, but come
off. First of all, I think we need to have a much richer understanding of what constitutes inflation. For a long time in India, inflation was understood purely in terms of WPI, right? Now, if you think in terms of WPI, my narrative is very straightforward from around the time when the petroleum prices crashed from $100 a barrel to $20 a barrel, WPI related inflation was simply off the table. Then we shifted the narrative to saying, no, we are actually talking about CPI inflation. But what is our benchmark for what is the norm in CPI inflation? What are the norms in CPI? Now, CPI inflation is a much more complicated. And because we don't have an integrated national market in final consumption goods. In many commodities, there are local pressures which operate because of supply constraints, because of limitations on movements of goods. Many things in our consumption baskets are perishable, so therefore they have a very narrow circuit in which they can move. Because of this, there is a considerable interstate variation in inflation indexes. These are still visible in the current CPI if you look at them. The index is an average of all of these. What exactly is the norm which we should be working on? My reading of it is that in India, we have been in a relatively low inflation world. And by low inflation, I actually tend to not look at the average, but look at the spectrum. And there are many, many states where inflation rates have been very modest now for many months to come, for a while. By focusing on averages in something where we have not quite understood how the nationwide market works, and a lot of the unpacking of CPI, I'm not particularly convinced, is particularly productive or useful to do, is, I think, missing the narrative. We are not in a high inflation regime. I mean, it's just important to understand that. And there is a need to look at the CPI data. The state level data has been available in public domain for at least 5 years now.
So what would you make of this current fall in inflation? Is it a one-off because of all of these, you know, vegetables and commodities like that? Or is it, if you were saying that underlying inflation was not there even when we had high headline CPI numbers, then what do we make of the numbers now?
What is high? You know, when I was in college, high was presumed to be something above 10. For a long
time.
Okay,
high benchmark to the 4% target that we have now, since we have a target.
Yeah, but I it's not my job to set the target, so I'm not going to that. Then you should ask people as to why did they choose.
No, so if we use that as a benchmark.
No, I think even with reference to that, we have been, I think, below it for almost a year, certainly. And if I were to count the number of states which were below it, there would probably be many more who are below it for more than a year in for a while. But what exactly is contributing to it? In part, food prices, which are driven by the availability of moisture and good monsoons, in part because there is also a natural dynamic in food prices that once they had gone up, and we worked the incentive regime, there was a supply response. The thing is, inflation should be looked at in terms of sustained periods of high high prices across a wide spectrum of goods. And if you were to take that as a classification, then you would actually find that we have been in a low price regime for a while.
So you disagree with the RBI and the MPC?
I don't agree, disagree. I'm stating my reading of the inflation picture.
Okay, sir, and which is that we have been in a relatively moderate inflation regime for a while.
Yeah.
Okay. So just a question on the CPI. How comfortable are you with the construction of the CPI now? Is it more or less in line with international standards in terms of particularly the, things like measuring rent, etc., financial services? Or would you want to see some adjustments on the CPI basket too?
No, I think as insofar as our current consumption pattern basket is concerned, CPI, we are very comfortable with the way it's being measured. I don't think there are issues in how rent is measured and so on. But we will have to, we need to constantly update CPI, taking into account changes in consumption pattern and so on. So we have a new consumption survey coming up, and I think it'll be right to review the CPI basket once the new consumption survey gets complete. So on those issues, I don't think there is a major issue insofar as CPI is concerned. What I am interested in, which is something which will need planning and work and some thinking about, is it is clear from our CPI data that spatial price differentials in India are important. And we need to get a much better understanding of how spatial price effects in India work, particularly price differences across states. Now, that is a more challenging exercise because it's not merely making CPI comparisons across states, because it's comparing apples to oranges. Ideally, need to do it in a consistent manner across states. Now, that's a challenging research exercise because we need to figure out a suitable basket which can be configured to make such interstate comparisons. We have some people working on this, and we will probably try to come up with some ideas for discussion when they complete their work. But it's an area which we need to look at more systematically, because understanding the spatial patterns of price formation in India are very important, given the fact that our markets are still integrating. GSTN will help us integrate more, but more than GSTN, we will need to get much better transports, logistic structures, integration, and how is that process working out? A spatial price dispersion matrix will help us understand that better.
Okay, so last question. We are moving closer to and are getting a better picture on the employment side, or at least attempts are being made both from your department side, plus there's a task force looking into what we can do to get us better employment data.
Yeah, I mean, the aim of the task force is to take stock of what we are doing, what we need to do, and also what is already available and how we can make better use of it. So employment is an area where there is a lot of possibilities. We have started some work. The labor force survey has been started. It will give more regular data. There will be need for more understanding of labor market issues. And I think the current debate in that sense has been very useful, because it has helped focus
the current debate about jobless growth, which you don't entirely
I think the narrative is wrong.
Okay.
But I welcome a focus on employment, because I have long been an advocate that labor markets are very important to understand the economy. And to the extent that policy interest has been focused on it, if we get more resources to better document the labor market, I think it will help everybody.
And you're saying the narrative is wrong because we are reading it wrong, not because the data is wrong.
No, I think yes, I think people have read it wrong. They have conflated incompatible data. They've read meanings into the stories which are simply not there.
Thanks so much, Dr. TCA Anant, for having this conversation with us.
Yeah.